Boa tarde, pessoal. Sejam todos bem-vindos à nossa aula inaugural do PPGEE, do nosso segundo semestre de 2021. Nessa aula, a gente convidou o professor George Zissis para apresentar... deixa eu só ver aqui o título da apresentação dele... Uma introdução breve, né, aos futuros desafios no domínio da ciência e tecnologia dos sistemas de iluminação modernos. Tá? Antes da gente começar a aula em si, eu gostaria também de dar um aviso aqui, que no dia 20 de outubro vai ser realizada a acolhida aos discentes, tá? aos discentes novos do PPGEE, então o coordenador vai explicar sobre o curso, sobre todos os detalhes, tá? Então, todos também vão ser bem-vindos, tá? Essa nossa aula, ela vai ser ministrada toda em inglês, tá? Então, eu só estou dando os avisos iniciais aqui, e logo a gente vai mudar o idioma aí para o inglês, tá? So, thank you very much for attending this inaugural class. We will receive today Professor George Zissis that will present the class titled A Short Introduction on the Future Challenges in the Domain of Science and Technology of Modern Light Systems. The speaker is Professor George Zissis from University of Toulouse III, Paul Sabatier. Regarding Professor George, he is Vice-Rector of the Toulouse III University from 2020 to 2023, and he has graduated in 1986 from Physics Department of University of Crete in General Physics. He got his Master and PhD in Plasma Science in 1987 and 1990 from University Toulouse III in France, and he is today this distinguished class professor in Toulouse III. His primary area of work is in the field of light sources, science and technology. He is the director of Light Lamp Matter Research Group of LAPLACE that enrolls 20 researchers. He has published 160 papers in referenced scientific journals and more than 300 papers in international conference. He was advisor for 36 PhD students, and he won in December 26 the first award of International Electrotechnical Committee Centenary Challenge for his work on normalization for urban lighting system, in conjunction with IEEE, IET, and the Observer. In 2009, he won the Energy Global Award for France and got the Fresnel Medal from French Illuminating Society. In 2011, he has been awarded the title of Professor Honoris Causa of St. Petersburg State University from the Russian Federation. And he was president of the Pós-Graduação, Optoelectronics and System section of the French National Council of Universities for the period of 2014 to 19. He was president of IEEE Industrial Application Society for 2019 and to 20. And he is chairman of the 4E Solid State Lighting Annex of the International Energy Agency from 2020 to 24. So, Professor George, be welcome to this class, and thank you very much for giving us this very nice class. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marco. Thank you for inviting me. Good afternoon to all of you. It's beginning of the afternoon for you, it's the end of the day for me. Well, okay, Marco, if we can share my screen, is ready. Okay, I will pass in slide mode. You can see my slide. It's okay, Marco? Marco, I cannot hear you. It's okay?
Yes, it's okay.
Okay. Well, let's, I will try to give you a short introduction on the science and technology of modern lighting systems. Well, short can be very long. I will try to keep it in a reasonable amount of time. Well, first of all, why we are looking on the science and technology of lighting? Because if you look around you, artificial light is everywhere. In fact, human being cannot live without the possibility to generate somehow artificial light. Look, for example, in this slide, you see my home city, Toulouse, illuminated the night. And you can see that here, the light sources may have multiple usages, like monument lighting, or street lighting, or indoor lighting, signage, displays. Of course, you have all the vehicles, cars, trains, ships, or aircrafts. There are plenty of light sources. And you have also a number of non-lighting applications of artificial light sources. What are the non-lighting applications? You can imagine some biomedical treatments, or you can imagine specific light sources for vegetables and greenhouse lighting. And of course, you can couple that inside a city and have a city-based greenhouse for production of local vegetables and all that stuff. Well, we will not speak here about non-lighting applications. Why we need this artificial light? Because beyond the usage, you have also functions. Artificial light should fulfill a number of functions. The first one is see, be able to see around you, and also be seen. The others can see you. If you take the best example is a car, when you use the frontal lights is in order to allow driver to see in the front of him. And when you take the back lights and the flash lights, it is for the other to see what the car is doing. Why we need to see around us in order to locate something, an object, a person, an animal, and not only locate it, but identify. We have to understand what is. I see something, what is that? Why that? Because this allows you to move securely in the city, in your home, in inside a building. That means artificial light makes secure the environment, but also make us to feel secure. We have to be careful, because feeling secure doesn't mean that you are secure. Well, of course, the light also allow us to communicate. Two types of communication. We can communicate by exchange light signals. This is the visual light communications, but also just imagine if you are in a dark space and you approach someone, you don't want to discuss with some persons because you don't see him or her. And this is a problematic. Of course, the light also can help us to appreciate something, appreciate that they are a beautiful monument, but also we can use the light in order to enhance this appreciation and make something more fancy. And finally, artificial light can create ambience, working ambience, relaxing ambience, festive ambience, and what you can expect other. Well, we have artificial light everywhere, you understood that, but when you look some global figures about lighting, you understand why we need to look more carefully in that domain. For example, here you can see that in our planet, we estimate that every day we have 30 billion electric lamps that operates worldwide. That means more than 3 lamps per capita. Of course, if you go to Western countries, this number is much larger, but if you go to some remote areas, this number could be zero electric lamps per person. That I'm showing you here is an average. And these 30 billion electric lamps use 13 to 14% of annual world electricity production, which is the equivalent of 2,900 terawatt hours. I remind you, tera is 10 to 12. That means this figure here is almost 3, 10 to 15 watt hours. If you assume that hot iron is 1 kilowatt, or maybe 3 kilowatt, in 1 hour consume 3 watt hours, that means this figure is the equivalent of 1,000 billion electric hot irons operating in our planet. 13 to 14% of electricity corresponds roughly to 2% of any type of energy consumed worldwide every year. And this energy, of course, is either coal, oil, gas, maybe radioactivity, or renewables. Now, if you produce electricity, 2,900 terawatt hours, you produce also greenhouse gas. In average, and if you calculate that, we estimate that lighting is responsible for the release of 1,150 million metric tons of greenhouse gas that is released every year in our atmosphere. This is the equivalent of 5% of world CO2 production, or the equivalent of the full CO2 production of 230 million people. On the other hand, 30 billion lamps is also an excellent financial generator. You see here the turnover of lighting industry, and lighting industry here take into account the lamps, the electronic circuits around the lamps and the fixtures, nothing else. And here, this turnover is in the order of 112 billion US dollars annually, which is one of the highest revenue for this type of industry, and with a growth rate which is almost constant since at least 30 years now, and the growth rate is in the order of 1%. And very important, today 30 to 45% of this revenue is coming from for LEDs, light emitting diode technology. This figure, maybe 5 years ago, it was less than 5%. You see here the incredible growth of this technology. We'll speak a little bit later. Well, globally, that I want to stress here is artificial lighting and lighting systems has a large impact on energy, environment, but also everyday's life and also world's economy. Well, as I told you, a human being cannot live without producing artificial light. And if you take this gentle caveman, well, of course, without electricity, he had to find other ways to produce artificial light. And he discovered two main processes that can convert energy to light. Since him, we never discover anything new. Those two methods, the incandescence and the luminescence, are still used today, and we don't have something new except that we use electricity to convert into light. Well, what is the problem here, or the problem, or the concept? If you take the incandescence, this is the hot way to produce light. You take heat, and you transform a part of this heat through incandescence to light. And this process is very inefficient. It's impossible to get efficient light sources based on incandescence. Well, the first discovery was, of course, fire, followed by torches, mobile or stable torches, candles. Here we arrive in the historical area, oil lamps. And the last evolution in that domain was the gas lamps. From the other side, our cavemen use also the cold way to generate light. Cold means you can inject energy to your system and you can get light with much better efficiency. And this phenomenon is called luminescence. Well, what it was known since the prehistorical times, of course, bioluminescence. I'm speaking here about fireflies, well, rather difficult to manage as artificial light source, or phosphorescent materials, also difficult to find. And when you have that, this is the Archean stone of the cinema. I don't remember the movie, the name. Well, when you have this type of materials, you are the most powerful guy of the around you. And of course, don't use it for generating light. Some materials, when you scratch or you heat, they can produce also luminescence, tribo or thermoluminescence. And of course, the best light sources that humanity knew from the beginning was lightning during the storms. Well, very difficult to use. It was more affrighting than useful. And for that way, before having electricity, human being said that, it's better to use the hot way. We can master that. And of course, if I have many fireflies, I can light up some areas, but that was very difficult. In any case, the dream of our caveman was that one, catch lightning, put in a bottle and use the bottle to light up. Of course, you are leaving when you see that, but we make it with electricity. We transform electricity through electrical discharges and we create lamps. And those electrical discharges in the lamps, they are that you see here, lightning in a bottle. Well, I want to say just two words about legacy technologies and more especially discharge lamps, because this technology now is sunsetting, and maybe during the next decade, it will be used only for some niche applications. Well, first of all, what is a discharge lamp? A discharge lamp is based on a plasma. Plasma is the fourth state of the matter. There are seven at least identified. And in fact, what is a plasma? If we just keep the position of an electrical engineer, a plasma, an electrical discharge, is an energy converter. That means one, you inject power in a gas that will transform into plasma. And the power, of course, electrical power here. And this plasma will transform the electrical power in radiation in all the spectrum, from visible, from UV to visible and to infrared area. And another part, it will be transformed in heat. Well, this is the definition of a discharge lamp, just an energy converter. And this principle has been demonstrated since the middle, even the beginning of 19th century. The first electric lamp that operated in our world was not an incandescent lamp as proposed by Edison, but it was a discharge lamp proposed 90 years before Edison by another very famous scientist, Faraday. Well, since then, taking into account all the knowledge that we have today for electrical discharges, how it operates, how we can supply, how we can optimize. We know if we change the pressure inside the tube, or if we change the components inside the tube, we can tune the quality of light, the quantity of light, and we can make what we want. Globally, this legacy technology called discharge lamps is a very large family of lamps. You see, we can have lamps with electrode inside. That means you bring the electrical power inside a sealed tube, or without electrodes. That means you bring the energy by irradiating from outside this this tube. You have high pressure, low pressure, fluorescent lamps, compact fluorescent lamps, mercury lamps, sodium, metal halides. I will not go into details, otherwise we will never finish the short introduction. Well, I want to say is today the bulk part of the artificial light is still produced by discharge lamps, because discharge lamps can produce a huge quantity of light. But maybe during the next decade, this part will reduce and the LEDs will make everything, or almost everything. I don't like to say everything. Well, what is the modern solution is that we call the solid state lighting. That means we will no more use plasma, but we will use matter at solid state in order to transform electricity into a light. And globally, we have two types, two families in the solid state lighting domain. One is the light emitting diodes, and the second is the organic light emitting diodes, which is almost plastic sheets able to produce light. Well, I wanted to take some time to speak to you about LEDs, then explain you what is organic LEDs, and after that, I wanted to show you how we can use this type of technologies, LEDs, OLEDs, or even legacy technologies in order to implement them inside modern and rather complex lighting systems. Well, just I want to remind you here, electroluminescence has been discovered in 1907, more than 100 years from now. The first color LED, red, has been produced in US in 60 years later, in 1962. And this technology penetrated the lighting area in 2000, thanks to the invention from Nakamura and two other Japanese, the blue light emitting diode. The technology became mature for lighting maybe from 2010. You see, this is, we are very close to our days. Concerning the organic LEDs, we discover that plastic sheets in some specific configurations can be semiconductors, or I will say semi-insulators, because the conduction is very low. This phenomenon has been discovered by Kodak in 1977. The first organic LED with enough production of light 10 years later. And the technology started to penetrate the lighting area in 2010. That means we are still in a domain that is not very mature. Just to tell you that the discovery of polymer conduction bring the Nobel Prize of Chemistry to their inventors in 2000, and the invention of the blue light emitting diode brings the Nobel Prize of Physics in 2014 to the three Japanese guys. Well, just to show you what is the electroluminescence discovery, well, this is just a small paper that you see here, intitulated "The Note on Carborundum." Carborundum at that time was the silicon carbide. Well, and the guy that you see here, the captain Henry Joseph Round, was the vice chair of Marconi in UK. He played in his laboratory with crystals of silicon carbide, and fortunately for him, inside it was some impurities, and when he polarized the crystal, he could obtain light, yellow, green, and even blue Blue is very very interesting because it is very difficult to produce. But of course, beginning of the 20th century, it was just the beginning of quantum theory, relativity, and all the modern physics. It was almost impossible to understand what happened inside the crystal and be able to explore this direction in order to produce light. How it works? An LED, in fact, you have two layers. This is a diode, one layer populated with a material that has excess of negative charges, electrons, and a second part, which is more doped with material that has an excess of positive charges that we usually call the holes. And if you put the two materials one on the top of the other, then I don't know if you are familiar or not with some solid state physics concepts, but the atomic levels will be distorted because you have the different materials, and then we will get that we call the bands. The material is described by two bands. One is the conduction band that you have upstairs, and downstairs here you have the bound part of the material. All charges here cannot move out, but charges from above can go down, and between them you have an empty space in energy, and this space here is called the gap. Well, if for some reasons you can push an electron from the conduction band to go back to the other band, then he will find a hole, he will recombinate, and the difference of energy is coming out, energy is conserved, come out as a photon. And when you look that, you understand that an LED naturally can produce only monochromatic light, can produce blue, red, yellow, or other colors, but it is impossible to produce from a single LED white light, which is a mix of different wavelengths. And the color, it depends on the type of materials that you use. The spectral width is very small, is almost monochromatic, is not so monochromatic like a laser, but it's not very far. And also when you write some relations, the color can change slightly if you heat the material. That means you can move, say, from deep red to more light red by heating the material. Then you can ask me how we produce white light from LEDs. Well, there are several methods. The most common is mixing red, green, and blue. That means, as you can see here in this slide, you can have different diodes, a green, a yellow, a red, and then you can mix them by using also a mixing optics, and you can see white. If you mix red, green, and blue, you can produce all the colors inside this triangle here. That means also you can produce white. The problem is, it's very difficult to produce the green spot here. And it's very simple when you produce this green LED to change very easily the wavelength. And if you pass from 530 nanometers to just 500 nanometers, which is very small, then all the white quality of light change. You pass from a good white light here to a very bad cold white light here. And this is very difficult to control. And of course, you have three elements, at least red, green, and blue. That means you need to control them independently. And here it was a very nice idea from a big lighting company. This is not to generate light, but it's just to make fun and make an object fancy. If you saw to your fixture here an object, the small cone here, a sensor can measure the color coordinates of the object and can arrange the three LEDs to produce the same color in light. Well, the problem is every color outside the triangles are not visible. The color temperature sometimes is very high, and you have very cold white light, which is not very useful for lighting. The color rendering also is not very good, because finally you have only three real colors. You have the impression to see white, but in reality you have three colors, and between them nothing. And also you have important optical losses, because you have to mix the three colors together in order to avoid some fancy effects. And of course, the control is far to be intuitive, because today when you do that, you need to have three different power supplies for a single chip. Here in this chip, you have four different LEDs. You need to have four different power supplies. Okay, however, the technology is advancing in that domain, and the Department of Energy in the United States, who is following the LED technology since more than 20 years now, they believe this RGB mixing can be the future for the LEDs. What we are using today, we are using mainly another artifact in order to produce white light. In fact, if you know a little bit about colorimetry, and if you take the color triangle here given by CIE, the colorimetry says if you have two opposite colors, here the blue and the yellow, you can generate all the colors in the straight line linking the two points. Look, if you do that, you can obtain white. Okay, that means if I have an LED, a chip here, producing blue light, and if I put on the top some phosphorescent material that absorb a part of the blue light and reduce it to yellow light, at the end you will have blue and yellow, and you will see white. Look at this small video here. Look up. And here the light becomes white. I don't know if it is very well visible. It's a colorimetry problem. This is blue. And when you put the phosphor in the top, the light becomes clearly white. Okay. Why I told you that in a few years from now, LEDs, we may replace the majority of any other legacy technology. Forget yet the incandescent technology. It is almost forbidden worldwide, it's banned. But it will replace also the discharge lamps. Why? Because just look how the light, the luminous efficacy, sorry, still in French, the luminous efficacy increases as the technologies becomes more and more mature. This is 1914 up to 2020. You see that all legacy technologies here, they are attaining a plateau. And when you look what happened with LEDs, you see that the efficacy is still growing. Look here, this is a more precise data that I got from different reports. This is the records of commercial products that has been measured. And you see that from 2008 to 2020, we passed from a luminous efficacy, of less than 60 lumen per watt, which is comparable to a compact fluorescent lamp. Today, we can achieve systems with almost 180 lumens per watt. We'll multiply the efficacy by three. That means you need three times less electricity to generate the same amount of light. And all the commercial products are following this evolution. This graphic is rather complicated to read. I will explain you. In fact, the points that you see here with the different colors correspond to the average of something like 2,500,000 data recovered by the Department of Energy in the US, by the equivalent in Australia, in Europe, and so on. And we make the average by splitting the efficacy in domains. The yellow line, which is the more interesting here, this one, is calculated by taking the products they are in the 5% of the best products that we have in our database. That means what? That means that in 2019, for a classic LED lamp like that one, you can expect for the best products in the market to have efficacies up to 120 or 130 lumen per watt, which is huge. But of course, some other products may be less efficient. Same thing also for high bay, low bay. Here you can achieve almost 180 lumen per watt, which is exceptionally high. Maybe 5 years ago, the most efficient white lamp that we had in the market was the small fluorescent lamp, the T5 tube, and the efficacy was in the order of 100 to 110 lumen per watt. You see that today we are well beyond that. Okay, then you tell me, yes, this plot here shows a linear increase. Could we continue that way indefinitely? The answer is not. We have some thermodynamic limits that can limit the maximum efficacy to around 300 lumen per watt. And then we have technological limits. And the DOE, the Department of Energy, made some projections and some models showing that maybe in a few years from now, in 2025 or a little bit later, if we use blue and yellow conversion, we can achieve efficacies up to 200 lumen per watt. We are not very far. And now if we switch to that we call the RGB, red, green, blue, with new technologies, we can achieve maybe 250 to 260 lumen per watt, which is an excellent figure in any case. Okay, what will be next in the domain of light emitting diodes? As I told you, is switching from blue-yellow, the invention that brings the Nobel Prize to Nakamura and to the two other Japanese 2014. If we switch from that technology to native polychromatic, that means mix of red, green, blue, and maybe other colors, we can achieve less losses. And if we have less losses, we increase the global luminous efficacy. Or we can imagine also the possibility to use a different type of architectures, instead to have a single diode junction, a single Schottky junction, which is the LED. Imagine a continuous junction in a vertical space using nanotubes and nanowires of different materials with different dopings. And that means the same nanowire can emit maybe red at the top and blue at the bottom. And that means we can mix all those radiation together and get very good white radiation. This type of technology is very nice. It has been demonstrated, but there are still very important problems. And the most important is here we are in nanometric scale. That means the distance between the nanowires is so small, and even if you send 10 volts, then the electrical field between the nanowires can go up to several kilovolts per centimeter, and that means you can have breakdowns and short circuits between the nanowires. Okay, that was for the LEDs. I told you that today we are able to produce light from plastic materials, and we call that technology the organic light emitting diodes. How it works: the organic light emitting diodes, they are also a stack, like a sandwich, of different organic semiconductors. You see here, you have a substrate in glass, you put a transparent electrode using ITO, and then you have an organic layer that could be done by polymers or by small molecules. I will not enter into details. And then on the top, you have another metallic electrode, could be transparent also, and then you can emit by recombine holes and electrons, recombine in that area here and obtain photons, okay? The technology that we use today is more close to that we call the small molecules. And it is very funny when you look that molecule here, the ILQ3, this structure that you have here is very similar to the structure of the chlorophyll. Chlorophyll, in fact, is a molecule that catch light and transform the light into voltage. It's like it's a photovoltaic, it's an organic photovoltaic, and this effect is reversible. We try to use chlorophyll to produce some organic LEDs. The system works, but the chlorophyll emission is in the infrared area and it's not very useful for producing light. However, if you use carotene from carrots, you can obtain very good green light beyond the fact that the carrots are orange. Okay? In fact, an organic light emitting diode is a diode like normal LEDs, but there are some differences. Well, from one side you have the organic here, and in the left side you have the inorganic. Well, what are the differences beyond that one is using inorganic materials and the other using organic materials? Here the diode behaves an AC rectifier. On the other side, the junction behaves also as a rectifier, current rectifier, but for a completely different reason, because the charges, they are not moving the same manner inside an inorganic semiconductor and an organic semiconductor. From one side, we have energy bands, the conduction band and the other band in the down lower area. And you have motion of electron and holes. Here, you don't have really motion of electron and holes, but electron and holes create a couple before recombinate. And this couple that we call exciton is moving inside the semiconductor. Well, globally, there are differences between the two. And this can be seen by the fact that here we have almost monochromatic emission from the inorganic materials. For the organic materials, we have large bands of emission. That means organic materials, potentially, if we are able to make the right mixes, can emit natively white light. All colors are possible. You can see here by playing with the length of the molecule, by playing by the category of the molecule, we can obtain everything. And the most easy to obtain is green. This is excellent because the most difficult to obtain with LEDs is green. Well, that means the two technologies, they are completely complementary. There is some ideas that has been demonstrated by Osram is as a desk lamp. The leaves that you can see here, they are panels of a size of, if I remember correct, is 10 centimeters to 2 or 3 centimeters large in a single device. Look here, some examples. This light up offices in different places in Japan. Japanese, they are well beyond many other countries in that domain. And in fact, that we can do is with organic things, we can make a full surface emitting light. This surface can be flat or can be incurved. Imagine a plastic film that you can put around any object, and this object can become luminescent. And if we have large surface, we avoid any glare effect. And this is very important also. Some examples, the OLED cafe of a Japanese friend who is professor in Yamagata University, and he moved this OLED cafe from light infer to light infer. Here you see some real offices in Japan with those sorry if I if I move the mouse, the slide change. Office in Japan lighted up with these OLED panels. Well, as I told you, the technology is still not very mature. We have many problems. Use it to make real lighting is very complicated, but we can imagine much more applications, and this is the way that all lighting technologies penetrate the domain. We start with some fancy objects. Here you see, for example, a mirror, which is illuminating. The mirror can detect that someone is in the front of the mirror and just switch off a part of the OLEDs, and you can see yourself, and the remaining part is illuminate your face. Here you have also artistic objects, okay? But you have also more funny applications like a Christmas tree by General Electric, or a organic LED pillow. I don't think that the idea is excellent, especially with the blue light, but okay, why not? And more funny also, you may have an OLED wedding dress that has been demonstrated maybe 5 to 10 years ago. Well, this is all I have to say about lighting source technology. And now I want to say a few words how, starting from the new solid state lighting technology, how you can achieve modern lighting systems. And I want to remind you here that lighting is undergoing at that moment to its fourth revolution. Most probably you heard about the expression Industry 4.0, four industrial revolutions. The first one was when we use vapor and mechanical power to industrialize. This is end of 18th century. Then mid of 19th century, the second revolution is the use of electricity. Mid of 20th century is the introduction of automation and computer in the industry. And today we are living the fourth revolution in the domain of industry, which is intelligent systems with communication capacity and that stuff. The same thing for the lighting, but if the first revolution of industry is around mid of 18th century, the first revolution of lighting is maybe 10,000 or 30,000 years ago, when the cavemen use fire to produce light and they create torches. This is lighting here, lighting 1.0. Lighting 2.0 is, of course, the arrival of electricity, mid of 19th century. Lighting 3.0 is the blue LED diode, has been invented in 1993. That means end of 20th century. And today we are somewhere here that we call lighting 3.5. Why I want to comment a little bit this graphic here? Because in fact, forget the fire and let's start from the moment that we use electricity to light up our homes, our cities, and all that stuff. At that moment, we are speaking 150 years ago, the only question that electrical lighting has to answer is light up, switch on and off the light. And if you do just that, the only thing for industry is to produce lamps. That's all. And maybe in order to be more concurrential that your friend that who is producing lamps also, you may be a little bit more inventive and you push the technology of lamps to something new and you make incremental changes. Okay, and this is begin of 20th century, around 1970, 72 more precisely, we have a big problem in our planet. Most probably all of you were not born, me and Marco, yes. We discovered that we had the first oil crisis and our governments discovered that lighting use huge amount of electricity and most of that electricity is spent without any control, and they introduce a new concept, which is the energy efficient lighting. This new concept, energy efficient lighting, completely restructure all the industrial lighting ecosystem. We see three big groups created by merging all the small companies that we had before. I'm speaking about Philips, General Electric, and Osram. And okay, this is still at the end of 19th century, of 20th century, sorry, when we had the LEDs, and the industry told, okay, LED is nice, we can use it for producing artificial light and light up the homes, the cities, and we wanted to sell that, but we need to do something more than before. And they introduced the concept of human-centric lighting. What means human-centric lighting? It means that we are able today, by controlling an electronic component, because the LED is an electronic component, we can control not only the quantity of light, but we can control also the quality of the light, we can control the distribution of the light, we can do much more things. That means we can, I will show you something later, we can adapt the light quantity, quality, and distribution to the human needs. And this concept was very interesting. On the other side, people working with sensors, they said, oh, we have presence sensors, motion sensors, temperature sensor, or natural light sensors, and all that stuff. Why not couple our sensors with lamps, whatever is the technology, and then we can have that we can connect it, lamps, connected with sensors, okay? And today we are using that technology. We can switch on and off the light when no one is inside a room. We can switch on and off in a city when a car is passing, and we can do many, many things. And this is the point that we are today, the lighting 3.5. We are trying to make interacting human-centric lighting and connected lighting, and somehow couple LED industry, the LEDification, with the information and communication technology industry. And if we achieve that, if we make communicating those two things or interacting, passing through the human being, this is very important, then we go through the fourth revolution of lighting technology, which is the smart lighting. And the smart lighting is very important because just look around you. You have around you in a couple of meters maximum at least one lamp, or maybe two, or maybe more. That means you have an excellent mesh that can be used in order to collect and transmit information, provide that you implement also sensors in that network. And starting from smart lighting, you can use the smart lighting as basis for smart buildings, for smart cities, and of course for smart grids. And then you can imagine to interconnect your mobile phones, your computers, your fridges at home, or I don't know what other, and the light bulbs and the lighting system becomes a single item, a single component of a complex systems that today we call the Internet of Things. This fourth revolution will be happening most probably something between 5 to 10 years from now. We are on the way, and it's very difficult to imagine that will not be successful. The problem is this new revolution will completely change again the lighting industry ecosystem, because the system will be so complex. The lighting system, from being a autonomous single system, will become a subsystem inside a Internet of Things, more complex stuff. And in that case, the industry will be not anymore able to sell you bulbs, fixtures. They will sell you a system, or maybe better, they will rent you the system, and you will pay for the light. The light will become a service. And also, as you can have communicating objects, light system can collect data, and this data can become a product for the company who is selling you the light. Of course, you can connect also your computers, your telephones, passing through visual light communication or Li-Fi concepts. And we are fully in the domain of digitalization of our society. Yeah, there is the concept of human-centric lighting. In fact, we discover end of 20th century that our circadian clock is synchronized every day thanks to the variation of natural light. When the sun is at the zenith, has not the same light quality and quantity when the sun is at the sunset or the sunrise. Well, and this variation of the quantity and quality of light interacts with our organism through our eyes and controls somehow the production of two hormones, melatonin, and melatonin is responsible for sleeping, and serotonin, which is responsible for awake and be alert. Well, starting from that principle, the lighting industry create the human-centric lighting concept because they discover that we can today, thanks to LED technology, it's not possible to do it with legacy technologies, we can create emotionally effective lighting. And this is very interesting. We can adapt the light to your needs. And also, if we take a very simple example, if you take elder people, the elder people have different needs of lighting than young people. And if we use the right light with this human-centric lighting concept, it is possible to light up better the home of a old person and allows him or her to live as long as possible autonomous to his own home. And this is something very, very important. But okay, I told you that we go through smart lighting system, but what is a smart lighting system? You will not find a definition. Well, I wrote one. And for me, a smart lighting system has a principal function, which is to produce at any moment, this is very interesting, any moment, the right light. That means when it is needed and where it is necessary. It should adapt the quantity and quality of light to enhance visual performance in agreement with the type of executed tasks. That means imagine a lighting system in your office or in your teaching room detects the people who are in the desk. It can recognize who is there, what he is doing, reading, writing, looking at his computer, or discussing or making a presentation or writing on the blackboard, and automatically can adapt the quality of the light that each person needs inside the room. Of course, it must guarantee the well-being, the health, and the safety of the end users. This is not negotiable. And also should not squander passively the resource of our planets, especially energy, and limit actively also the effects of light pollution on the biotope. The artificial light can completely affect the life of animals, plants, birds, and what we have around us. And if we interact with our biotope, we can destroy our biotope if we use the bad quality of light. And ideally, it could offer additional service, like, for example, geolocalization effect, like GPS, or data connectivity for your computers, for your cellular phones. And well, if you have that, then you have to fulfill several functions. I will send Marco my slides. You can read the functions afterwards. Just some examples. Look, for example, in a city, you may have lighting poles that they can communicate among them. They can communicate with smartphones, with smart cars. They can detect people, they can detect cars, and they can adapt to the quantity of light that we need at any moment. Look here, a small example. You see the light here is rather down. Someone is arriving. Then the poles are switching on at the maximum, following the person, and behind in principle, we switch down again the lighting. We can keep a minimum level. You can see it here. The same thing if you have a bicycle arriving on the other side. You can calculate the speed of the bicycle and calculate how many lighting poles you have to switch on and off and things like that. Well, also this type of lighting system inside a city can reduce vulnerabilities because as they can communicate with objects, they can detect curious behaviors. An example, this nice guy here after a nice fiesta, well, he's going out in the street. Normally he is in the pedestrian area, but you know very well, normally if you are normal, you are walking straight. This is not his case, it's more zigzagging. But if the intelligent lighting pole can detect this zigzag thanks to a connection to the smartphone or thanks to a camera, can detect that someone has a curious behavior in the street and just broadcast the information to the cars by telling, be careful, when you arrive at this area, you may have a UFO that can arrive in the street at any moment and you may have an accident. And then you protect the more vulnerable person, him, but also you protect the cars. Of course, in some other countries, especially in China, you can broadcast the information to the police also, and they come immediately collect the guy and the problem is solved. It's not acceptable by any type of society that. Okay, well, in a city, a communicating system can be used in order to regulate traffic lights, to send information to the cars about traffic speed limits, and even can regulate the speed automatically between the cars, and all that can facilitate the traffic inside the cities. It can also locate, for example, empty parking spaces. This system is experimented here in Toulouse. The lighting poles can detect the empty space and they broadcast the information to the mobile phones, and people can know that at that place there is an empty space for parking. And it is very interesting because normally all of us, when we are living in a rather big city with parking problems, we are roaming every day something like 20 minutes before finding a parking spot. And if you do that with thermal cars or even with electrical car, you squander energy. Okay, that I'm telling also, then imagine everything communicating with everything. You have to be very careful because here, this type of systems can be very intrusive for our private lives. And well, then the question is when we have to stop. But we know how to do it. It's no more science fiction. Well, look here at what should seems this system. You start from the electrical network. You need to have a microgrid controller. Then you can connect renewables. You can have storage units. And then you can feed either with a 230 volts AC, the driver of each lamp, or today we are tend to replace, at least in short distances, inside buildings or even inside the cities, the AC cables with a DC power. Imagine a 400 volt backbone cable in the middle of the building. Very easy to connect there wind production or solar production and things like that. But then when you arrive inside the room, you have a DC to DC converter and you pass for 400 volts to say to 48 volts. This is very interesting because inside the room, you have no more any appliance using AC. All the appliances that we have, they have AC-DC converters inside, which is very inefficient compared to a DC-DC converter. And if you stay under 40, under 50 volt, then you can suppress the earth wire because you don't have any more problems for the protection of persons. And then you can save no more energy, but you can save kilometers and kilometers, millions of kilometers of copper wire. Then the driver sends the information to the light, switch on the light, can communicate with sensors, can communicate also with other lighting systems, with other objects. And all that, the objective is to produce the best light for the task illumination. Here, illuminate the city in order to avoid accidents, to avoid criminality. But on the other side, has to switch off the light or limit the distribution of the light in order to avoid and limit light pollution. Something very funny, here you see antennas. These antennas, they are serving to collect information or receive control sequences. And that means somehow, somewhere you have a data center. And a data center today consume much energy. You know that in 2019, the world consumption of data centers was 11% of the electricity, which is very comparable to the consumption of lighting. That means be careful when you implement such very complex systems. Don't forget that you make energy economies from one side, but you may spend much more energy on the other side, and you have to find the right compromise. Okay. To show you that all the objects that we need today, and I almost finish, all the objects that we need for these smart lighting systems are there. It's no more science fiction. We are able to take all the components. Some of them, they are really in maturity level. Some others, they are arriving in the maturity level. And we are sure that they will arrive there because they are used not only for lighting, but for many other appliances. Well, that means in a few years from now, we will be really able to produce this smart lighting system that can make, I'm leaving myself also, can make everything, maybe also coffee. But well, I don't think that I'm wondering to my lighting system to produce coffee, but who knows, maybe someone is interested by that. Well, this is almost my last point. That we have to keep in mind is when we go to such complex technologies, the best option is really to produce a system that gives us the right human-centric smart lighting. That means light up smart where it is needed and when it is necessary, and the best as possible. This is the main keywords that you have to have in mind. How you can do that? You can use existing technology or technology that will arrive in the next years, take into account the human and social needs, calculate the impacts in the environment, in the society, and all that stuff, and feedback the technology in order to enhance the technology and make this circle really virtuous. In any case, please remember always that illuminate, in any case, doesn't mean flood objects, people, or buildings with light. If you do that, you lost everything. And if we achieve all that stuff, the smart lighting will contribute to solve several world grand challenges, contribute to energy savings, we don't discuss about that, reduce light pollution, impacts on the biotope, contribute to healthy working environments with high task performance, contribute also to silver economy, I explained you why, and of course contribute to the rise of lighting and IT, information technology industry. How to achieve that? Well, what is the target? We need to define the target. The target is we need an innovative lighting system, a smart lighting system that should be energy effective, environmental friendly, user friendly, and of course, produce high performance light for high performance and quality of life. This is the four items. And to do that, we need high quality research at academic level, but at any level, and finally. When we do research, we discover new things, and the new things sometimes we cannot quantify because we don't have the standards, we don't have the appropriate metrology, and then we have to produce those new standards and metrology. Then the industry has to take the concept from the academia and transform it into a product. This is the technological development. Here, in fact, you have R&D, research and development. You need to create extra legislation because existing legislation is very limiting. And especially when we discover something new, there is a big chances that this something new is forbidden because it's not included in the existing legislation. You need also extra legislation in order to push people to acquire the new systems. That means you need to create inciting measures because the system is expensive. You need to train high-level researchers, engineers, but also resellers. You need also finally to train people, because when you buy a lamp now in the supermarket, if you don't understand what is the quantities that is written in the box, you cannot make your choice easily, and most of all you will be unhappy. That means you have to have a good social knowledge. If you don't have that, it's not possible. And of course, the industry has to have a good market knowledge to know at what level and what we can sell to such or such population. Okay, and I will conclude here by just remind you that today artificial light is the unique human artifact visible from the space. And if you want to be good, normally this artificial light is down to light up us, not the sky. Well, it's not a good idea, but still is the only thing that astronauts can see from from the sky. Okay, well, that's all. If you have questions, I will stop the sharing the screen. Marco, it's up to you.
Thank you very much, George. Thank you for this. No, it was a very nice class. Today is Teacher's Day in Brazil, so congratulations for you too.
Thank you.
and thanks for this very nice class, George. We have many comments and some questions here. I will put some of them on the screen, so you can answer them.
Yeah, I see some of them. The first one is from Victor. Organic LEDs will replace LEDs? The answer is no. Organic LEDs has a completely different... Sorry, I have to change the light somehow. Okay, you seem like a ghost.
Yes, you are kind of...
Just a moment. I will try to cut the green screen. This is better. Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, this is better. No, organic LEDs, they have completely different set of application from LEDs. The two technologies, they are complementary. They are not in concurrence.
Okay. We have a comment here from Professor Henrique Braga. That is the first time he heard about lighting 4.0.
Yes. Well, this is I try to copy industry 4.0, and I saw people that lighting has much longer evolution than any other industrial product. Well,
we have some questions here from Igor. How can we assure that the limited earth resources are spent in a sustainable way? What kind of government regulations do we need to see in a short-term future?
Well, okay. The first one is try to limit, of course, the energy consumption. Limit the energy consumption, you can do it by offering more efficient systems. But there is a problem here. Is that we call the Zavon's paradox. What means the Zavon's paradox is... that when people has in the hand a more efficient technology, use that technology in order to produce more product than before. And that means all the energy economies that you make by the higher efficiency, you lost it by producing more. Well, how you can discard the Savon's paradox or rebound effect is the same name. How you can avoid it by using a smart system which is not intrusive but can adjust the light to what you need at any moment. You are not tempted to go change and request more. But even if you do it, the system can learn and can understand that you need more. And then the next time will propose you something better. And in that case, in one moment, the system will win and you will accept the quantity of light that it offers you. And this is positive. This is one point. The second point is absolutely we need to be able to recycle. To recycle the products. And this is a huge problem today with LED technology because we can recycle some parts of the bulb, the plastic parts, the electronic part, the metallic parts and so on. But the semiconductor itself, which contain rare earths and very rare materials, we don't know how to recycle. But there is intensive research today in several countries in order to find ways to recover the material. And this is true not only for LEDs, but this is true also for any electronic circuit, any electronic chip. We don't know really how to recycle the material that is inside the chip. That means efficiency coupled with intelligence and recycle is the three ways to achieve that objective.
We have another question from Igor. It's very interesting. In your opinion, what are the main skills that a smart lighting professional needs to have in order to keep innovating and creating better solutions?
Yes, very, very, very interesting question. In fact, I'm running a European project in order to imagine the job roles and skills that the illuminating engineers and people working with lighting will need in the future. It's very difficult to resume in a few words, but of course, first point is he need to understand lighting fundamental principles. What is the different quantities, the different qualities, how you measure that is one point. Second, he has to master the technology, understand what are the limits of the technology. This is very important. Then he has to have good artistic skills, because if you want to illuminate something, people want to have pleasant light. And this is more artistic than technological. You need to understand what are the human needs. What are the quantities and the distribution of light that you may need in order to illuminate an object? If you don't know that, you cannot do it. You need to understand also what are the impacts of artificial light in the other species around us, not only for the human. And of course, you have to understand also, as I told you, all the societal problems and also all the economics around the lighting. Of course, no one can master all that points, but you can imagine different role profiles for the lighting engineers of the future with a common knowledge, which is the fundamentals, and then have additional modules with specific knowledge that you may need for such or such a specific operation. And maybe you can imagine a lifelong training scheme that you can acquire more knowledge later according to your job evolution and your needs. Unfortunately, there is no a single answer to your question.
Thanks, George. We have a question here from Professor Henrique Braga. If you have some experience with insect killing backlighting lamps, mm-hmm. fluorescent and LEDs, UVA, UVB spectrum, do you believe they could be dangerous to people around?
UV, in any case, is not very friendly for people. you must to avoid expose yourself to this type of lights. This is the first point. Then in some case you can generate also ozone. For example, today with COVID, and we see many people that are trying to sell air purifying units using UVC radiation, which is very, very dangerous. And they told you, no, there is no problem because we protect completely the system. You cannot put your hand inside. This is one point. But of course, UVC completely kills all viruses. No problem, including the SARS-CoV. No problem. But this UV radiation generates also ozone. And in a closer space, the ozone is more dangerous than the COVID virus. Well, it's better to open the windows and forget the UV light. For the insect, it's another problem. Usually this type of lamps, they are very high. You cannot look directly. It's UVB or UVA, which is not so dangerous, but something which is much more dangerous. And here in Europe, we discussed to suppress that, is that the sun tanning cabins using UV lamps in order to have nice sun tan color in your skin. You can get it, yes, but if you do it a long time and several times, you can catch also some very nice skin cancers.
We have another question here from Professor Jason. Is about visible light communications. And he asks if do we already have an ideal optical receptor system to enjoy the advantages of the visible light communications?
Yes, receptors, it exists. Maybe the ideal one will be to take your phone and transform your screen that could be made by OLEDs. OLEDs produce light when you send a voltage, but when they receive light, they can produce a voltage. Maybe an idea is to transform the screen of the telephone to a receptor, to antenna. This is a concept. It's not so easy to make, but this is a concept. The question is, with Li-Fi, is if Apple, IBM, and these companies will adopt it in the near future. If they adopt it, I'm sure that Li-Fi, beyond the fact we have some technical problems to solve, it will be used in the future. If they will not adopt it, forget it, it will die, and 5G or 6G will replace it very, very well. But someone looks inside the code of iPhones, and he found that there is a line of code that is telling in clear Li-Fi ready. I don't know if it is a fake or if it is a real information, but if Apple and other things are thinking to use Li-Fi, this is a very important issue.
I think that this is related to this next question from Philippe Luz. He asks if do you see this technology being present in our day-to-day life in the near future?
Yes and no. Yes and no. It depends on the applications. Of course, if my computer can connect through the lamps, this is good. There is another problem, however, is the lamps should be on. And if you don't need the light, if you keep it on, it's not a good idea, you spend energy. But it seems that we can dim down the lamp at 1% of the level, which is neglectable. It's almost the standby power of the driver. And in that case, you can still transmit information. Well, yes, maybe not. Inside aircrafts could be a nice solution because you avoid to have electromagnetic effects with the other avionics systems inside the aircraft, and Li-Fi can be used, we demonstrate a Li-Fi system in a flight from Toulouse to Paris just before the COVID period, with 36 gamers playing inside the plane, connected directly by Li-Fi. And it was a game, a contest that needs high speed, and it was the sponsor was Qualcomm. It's a technology that we developed in my lab and in La Tecoera, a lighting company. Air France was partner, and Air France equipped an aircraft for just one flight with 36 Li-Fi lighting spots inside the cabin, and it worked for 1 year, for 1 hour and a half flight, no problem, no disconnection, high rate of connection, excellent. But still not certified avionics.
Thank you, Professor George. One last question I'd like to ask you is to for you to explain about the IEEE Smart Lighting workshop. Yeah. That will be held next week. So if you can explain a little bit about it. Okay. And to say that I put the link to register in here in the chat.
Thank you for that. I'm looking my watch because at 8 o'clock I have an IEEE meeting. Well, it's okay. That means 5 minutes is enough. Well, inside IEEE, we create a smart lighting project financed by that we call in IEEE the Future Direction Committee. They put some $20,000-$25,000 per year as seed funding in order to create a new entity inside IEEE around smart lighting. And one of our first actions will be to have next Tuesday at 9 o'clock New York time. That will be maybe I don't know what time in your place, Marco.
10 a.m.
10 a.m. Okay. We'll have a 3 hours workshop with some very nice speakers that they will try to explain what are the issues and the objectives of smart lighting systems for smart cities. Well, you are very welcome to join. The seminar is free. You need just to register. And Marco, just for you, I got the information yesterday evening by Marceda. We have yesterday 166 registered people yet in the seminar, and it's still increasing, which is very nice.
Okay, thank you very much, George. I have here the link to register to this workshop. And thank you very much for your very nice class. And thanks for being a partner of our group and our graduate program.
I thank you for inviting me. And I will send you afterwards a PDF with my slides. You can share with the students.
Thank you very much, George.
You are welcome.
Obrigado a todos pela presença também. Quem quiser se registrar, então, nesse workshop que vai ser terça-feira que vem, tem o link aí. Vai ser bem interessante, são 3 horas, 7 apresentações a respeito de Smart Lighting. Obrigado por comparecer à nossa aula inaugural do PPGE nesse segundo semestre de 2021. Muito obrigado.
Obrigado e bye-bye.